Welcome back, students. So this video is for the students of class 9th, subject science, chapter number 10, that is gravitation, and this is your lecture number 2. So students, in today's lecture, topics to be discussed are Kepler's laws. Okay, there are 3 laws of Kepler. After that, we shall discuss what do you mean by free fall and acceleration due to gravity. And then we shall proceed towards the variation of g. G means acceleration due to gravity at equator and poles. So let's start with today's lecture. First topic is Kepler's laws. Basically, there are 3 laws given by Kepler, and these 3 laws, they govern the motion of the planets. So what are these 3 laws? Number 1, the orbit of a planet is an eclipse with sun at one of the foci. Okay? You know that the planets, they revolve around the sun in circular path or in their orbits. Okay, so that orbit in which the planet is revolving, it is not circular. It is not circular, it is an elliptical path. That's why I have written ellipse. The orbit shape is ellipse. And sun is situated at one of the foci. Let us understand this concept. Here, this is a circle. Okay, and this is a center of the circle. Now, if I take any point on this circle and I join these lines, they all are equal. Okay, all these points present on the circumference of the circle, they are equidistant at the center. Okay, so this is the circular path. But what happens in ellipse or what happens in elliptical path? The elliptical path, it is like this. It is not circular. It is ellipse, elliptical path. Okay. In case of circle, there is only one. There is only one and only one foci. But in case of elliptical path, there are 2 foci. Okay. This is focus number 1 and this is focus number 2. Okay. Focus is singular. Single focus, and when more than one focus are there, we say foci, that is plural of focus. So in case of elliptical path, there are 2 foci, F1, F2. Okay, and out of these 2 foci, the sun is situated at one of the foci. Okay, the planets, they are revolving around the sun. And the sun is situated at one of the foci. So the orbit of a planet is an ellipse, that is an elliptical path with sun at one of the foci. Clear? This was the first law given by Kepler. Coming to second law. Second is the line joining the planet and the sun sweep equal areas in equal intervals of time. Sweep means cover. Okay. Now you know that this is an elliptical path in which the planets are revolving and the sun is situated at one of the foci. So let us consider this foci where the sun is situated. Okay. Now the line joining the planet and the sun. Suppose the planet is here. Okay, so the line joining the planet and sun sweeps equal areas in equal intervals of time. Suppose after time t, the planet is here. Okay, after time t, the planet is here. Now the line joining the sun and the planet. Okay, so this much area that will be equal to this much area if this distance traveled is time t, equal intervals of time. From this point to this time, suppose I say it is 10 hours. And from this point also it is 10 hours. So the time interval is equal. Okay, so the line joining the planet and the sun, they sweep equal areas in equal interval of time. Okay, so area of triangle this is equal to area of triangle this. Okay, the condition is the time interval should be equal. Third law given by Kepler. The cube of mean distance of a planet from sun is proportional to the square of its orbital period. Okay, the cube of mean distance. Okay, we have calculated the mean distance. Okay. There are so many distances traveled by the planet from the sun. So we have calculated in a year what is the mean distance, the average one. So the mean distance, suppose the mean distance is r. The cube of mean distance, that is r cube, is proportional to the square of time period or the orbital period. What is the orbital period? Orbital period means the time taken to complete one revolution. Okay, the time taken to complete one revolution, that is orbital period. So the r cube, the cube of mean distance, proportional to square of orbital period. R cube directly proportional to t square. Okay, and we can remove this proportionality sign. We can take any constant. So r cube divided by t square. We are shifting t square here. So r cube by t square, that will be equal to some constant. So these are the three laws given by Kepler. So these are called as Kepler's laws. Clear, students? Proceeding to our next topic. That is free fall. Now, what do you understand by a free fall? Whenever the objects they fall towards the earth. Okay, suppose this is an object. It is falling towards this earth in downward direction. Okay, so which force is responsible for the falling of the objects toward the earth? It is the gravitational force, right? So, whenever the objects fall towards the earth under this gravitational force alone, we say that the objects are in free fall. Okay, the only gravitational force is existing between the object which is falling towards the earth. So, that object is in free fall. Okay? Now, whenever the object is falling towards the earth, is there any change in direction of motion of the object? No, there is no change in the direction. The direction of motion is same, that is in downward direction. Is there any change in the magnitude of velocity? Yes, because object is falling towards the earth. So, due to Earth's attraction, there will be a change in the magnitude of the velocity. Okay, if there is change in velocity means there is some acceleration. What is acceleration? Change in velocity. So if there is change in velocity means there is some acceleration. Okay, so whenever an object falls towards the earth, an acceleration is involved. We can say this. So what is that acceleration? That acceleration is basically the earth's gravitational force. Okay, the direction of motion is same when the object is falling towards the earth, but due to earth's attraction there is change in the velocity, and there if there is change in velocity means there is some acceleration. So what is that acceleration called? That acceleration is earth's gravitational force. That is due to the earth's gravitational force, and that acceleration is called as acceleration due to gravity. Okay, the acceleration is due to gravitational force which is acting on the object when it is falling towards the earth. So what is the name of that acceleration? That acceleration is acceleration due to gravity, and this is represented by small g. There is a difference between capital G and small g. Capital G is what? It is gravitational constant, universal gravitational constant. And small g is what? It is acceleration due to gravity. Okay? Now, let us calculate the value of small g. That is acceleration due to gravity. Now, we know that from the second law of motion, force is equal to mass into acceleration. Okay, so force is ma. Now, when the object is falling towards the earth, so that acceleration becomes acceleration due to gravity. Okay, the acceleration is due to gravitational force now. So that acceleration will become equal to acceleration due to gravity. So we can write force is equal to mg. Now we also derived force is equal to gmm by d square. Okay. Now equate these two equations. This is equation 1. This is equation 2. Equate these two. We will get mg is equal to gmm by d square. Now small m and small m, they will get cancelled. So g is equal to gm by d square. Okay, what is g? G is acceleration due to gravity. And capital M is the mass of earth. Okay, we have taken the case that object is falling towards the earth. So small m is the mass of the object and capital M is the mass of earth. And d is the distance of separation between these two. Okay, so what is g? G is acceleration due to gravity. Capital G is gravitational constant. Capital M is mass of earth. And d is the distance between the object and earth. Okay, so this is the equation for acceleration due to gravity. And from this equation, what we can see that g, that is acceleration due to gravity, it is independent of the mass of falling body. Okay, in this equation small m is not there, no, means the mass of the object is not there. So this g is independent of mass. It does not depend upon the mass of object, whether it is heavy, light. Okay, So this was about acceleration due to gravity. So this was the case when the object was falling towards the earth. Okay, it was at some distance d. Now, if I say that the object is near or at the earth's surface, so what will be the value of g? So this is the earth. Okay, and the object is present near or on the earth surface. Okay, so what will be the value of g? Force is equal to mg, where m is the mass of the object and g is acceleration due to gravity. Also, force is equal to gm, that is capital M, the mass of earth. Okay, so force is equal to gmm upon r square. If I take the distance of separation between the earth and the object as r, that will be the radius of earth, na? If the object is present at the earth surface or near the earth surface, the distance of separation will be radius. So we are replacing d by r. So equate these equations now. When you will equate these two equations, we will get mg is equal to gmm by r square. Now m and m get cancelled. Okay, so g will be equal to gm by r square. In the previous case, we were getting g is equal to gm by d square. What was d? D was when the object is present here and it is falling downwards. So this distance was g. Now the object is present at the earth surface, so the distance will be r. Okay, so the formula is same. Just see the distance what you need to take. Clear? So this is the acceleration due to gravity. It is independent of the mass of the object. It does not depend upon the mass of the object which is falling freely towards the earth. Clear, students? Now we are going to study what will be the variation of this g at equator and poles. So we all are aware that the earth, it is not a perfect sphere. Okay, the earth, it is not a perfect sphere. So the radius of the earth, it increases from poles to the equator. So the value of g, that is acceleration due to gravity, it will become greater at the poles and less at equator. Okay, I'm telling you again, the radius of the earth, it will be increasing from poles to the equator. So we can say the radius is more at the equator. Okay, and we know that g is equal to gm by r square. Okay, from this equation we can see that if r is more, g will be less, because g is inversely proportional to r square. Okay, so if r is more, radius is more, g will become less. If radius is less, g will be more. Now we know that the equator, the radius is more, so g will be less at equator. And at the poles, what will happen? Radius is less, so g will be more at poles. What is the reason? G is inversely proportional to r square. Okay, so the value of g becomes greater at the poles than at the equator. Okay, so this was about the variation of g at equator and poles. Now You all are aware that capital G, that is universal gravitational constant, and it is a value of 6.67 into 10 to the power minus 11. Okay, and the small g, that is acceleration due to gravity. So what will be the value? We have to calculate, we have to know. So now we are going to calculate the value of g, that is acceleration due to gravity. We know that g is equal to gm by r square. So if we know the values of capital G, capital M and capital R, that is universal gravitational constant, mass of earth and radius of earth, we can find out the value of G. Okay, so capital G you know, 6.67 into 10 to the power minus 11. What is M? Mass of earth. The mass of earth is 6 into 10 to the power 24 kg. And what is R? R is radius of the earth, and the radius of earth is 6.4 into 10 to the power 6. Now substitute these values in this equation and find out the value of G. So after substituting the values, you will get the value of G as 9.8 meter per second square. Okay? That is acceleration due to gravity of earth. So what was capital G? 6.67 into 10 to the power minus 11. And what is small g? That is 9.8. Its SI unit was Newton meter square kg inverse square. Now what will be the SI unit of G? G is basically acceleration. It is due to acceleration. And what is the SI unit of acceleration? Meter per second square. So the SI unit of acceleration and the SI unit of G, they are same. So the answer is 9.8 meter per second square. Clear? So this was about the value of G. Now, in chapter number 8 motion, we studied three equations of motion. That is, V is equal to U plus AT, S is equal to UT plus half AT square, and V square minus U square is 2AS. Okay, now here, since acceleration is what? Acceleration here is acceleration due to gravity. So we will replace A by G. So V is equal to U plus GT, S is equal to UT plus half GT square. V square minus U square is equal to 2GS, where V is final velocity, U is initial velocity, T is the time taken, S is the distance covered. Okay, and acceleration will be positive when it is in the direction of velocity. And acceleration will be negative when they is in the opposite direction. Means it the opposes the motion. Okay. Here A is replaced by G. Clear students? So this was all about today's lecture. What is your homework? Your homework is solve example number 10.2. And 10.3 of chapter number 10, gravitation, plus in text question number 1 and 2 given on page number 136. Okay, these are just one line answers. They are direct questions. You can do them easily. And you have to solve exercise question number 8, 9, 10, 11 and 13. Aims of lecture number 1. Exercise question. Question number 1 was, how does the force of gravitation between the two objects change when the distance between them is reduced to half? Now, according to universal law of gravitation, we know that the force of attraction between the two bodies is given by the formula F is equal to G M M by D square, where M and M, these are the masses of the two objects, and capital G is a gravitational constant, and small d is a distance of separation between the two bodies. Now, in the question, it is saying the distance between the two objects is reduced to half. So, force will be equal to G M M by this distance is reduced to half. So, d by 2 whole square. Okay, now open this bracket. F is equal to G M M by D square by 4. Okay, now shift this 4 in the numerator part. F is equal to 4 G M M by D square. Okay, now this force will be new force. When distance is reduced to half, this force will be new force. So we know that G M M by D square, that is the original force. So we can write that F dash is equal to 4 times of original force. Okay, so what we can see that when the distance between the two objects is reduced to half, the force of attraction will increase by 4 times. Okay, the new force has become 4 times of original force. So this was question number 1. Coming to question number 2, gravitational force acts on all the objects in proportion to their masses. Why then a heavy object does not fall faster than a light object? Okay, we know that G is equal to G M by D square, where G is acceleration due to gravity. That is equal to G M by D square. Now, in this equation, you will see that this G, it is independent of the mass of the object. Okay, this M is mass of Earth. In this equation, the small m is not there, that the mass of the object is not there. So we see that the G is independent of the mass of the object. So whether the object is heavy or light, G does not depend upon it. Okay? All the objects, they fall on the bottom with constant acceleration. That is acceleration due to gravity. That's why the heavy objects, they do not fall faster than the light object. Okay? If there is no air resistance. This is the condition. Air resistance is not present. Clear? Coming to question number 3. What is the magnitude of the gravitational force between the Earth and a 1 kg object on its surface? The mass of the Earth is given and the radius of the Earth is also given. Okay. Now apply the formula. F is equal to GMM by D square. Okay, you have to calculate the magnitude of this gravitational force. You know G. You know M, that is mass of Earth. You know mass of the object, that is 1 kg. And you know the distance also. The radius of Earth is given. So just substitute the values. So applying these values in the equation, we get force is equal to 9.8 Newton. Okay, upon solving this, you will get the answer as gravitational force is equal to 9.8 Newton. So this is the magnitude of the gravitational force. Okay. Coming to question number 4. The earth and the moon are attracted to each other by the gravitational force. Does the earth attract the moon with a force that is greater or smaller or the same as the force with which the moon attracts the earth? Why? You know that moon, it revolves around the earth. Okay, the moon revolves around the earth. And the earth and the moon, they are attracting to each other with the help of gravitational force. Okay. And what is that gravitational force? F is equal to gmm by d square, where m and this m, these are the mass of earth and mass of moon. So the earth is attracting the moon, or the moon is attracting the earth, one and the same thing. So the earth attracts the moon with the same force with the moon attracts the earth. Okay, both the forces, they are equal, but they are in opposite direction. Okay, the force will be same, but it will be in opposite direction. And what will be that force? Gmm by d square. Coming to question number 5. If the moon attracts the earth, why does the earth not move towards the moon? The moon attracts the earth with the same gravitational force as the earth attracts the moon. I discussed right now, the forces are equal, but the direction is in opposite. Now, you know that the mass of earth, it is very, very large. Okay, the mass is very, very large of the earth. And according to Newton's third law of motion, according to Newton's second law of motion, force is equal to mass into acceleration. From this equation, we can say acceleration is equal to F upon M, or acceleration is inversely proportional to M. Now, if mass is large, acceleration will be small. So, the mass of the earth is large, so the acceleration produced is negligible. Therefore, the earth does not move towards the moon. Okay, the moon attracts towards the earth. Okay, this is the earth and this is the moon. The moon is revolving around the earth. Now, the mass of the moon is small as compared to the mass of the earth. Okay, and the mass of the moon is small means acceleration will be large. That's why it is attracted towards the earth. That is due to centripetal force. But the mass of the earth is very large, so the acceleration produced is negligible. So the earth does not move towards the moon. Okay, coming to question number 6. What happens to the force between the two objects? First part is the mass of one object is doubled. You know that force is equal to gmm by d square, capital M and small m. Okay, force is equal to gmm by d square. Now, in the question is saying the mass of one object is doubled. Okay, so force, new force will be g, mass of any one object, you can double it. I am doubling of this one, 2m, m upon d square. Okay, so f dash is equal to 2gmm by d square. Okay, and this quantity, that is original force. Okay, so F dash is equal to twice of original force. So the new force will be twice of original force, or we can say the force becomes doubled. Second part is the distance between the two objects is doubled and tripled. Calculate number one for doubled. Force is equal to gmm by d square. Okay, now the distance is doubled, so it will become, new force will be gmm, distance is doubled, so 2d whole square, d square is, so 2d whole square, so that will be gmm upon 4d square. Or we can say that this is what gmm by d square, that is force, original force. So that is equal to F by 4. So the new force become 1/4 of original force. Okay. Similarly, third part. For this tripled one, you can calculate F is equal to G M M upon D square. Okay. And what will the F dash? F dash will be GMM D square. D is tripled now. So 3D whole square. That will be GMM 3D into 3D 9D whole square. So we can say that will be F by 9, because this whole term is F. So F by 9. So the new force become 1 by 9 of original force. Okay, 1/9. Now coming to the last part, third part. If the mass of the both objects are doubled, now force is equal to gmm by d square. Now we are doubling the mass of both the objects, so the new force will be g, double these two, 2m upon 2 into 2m upon d square. So g, 2 2 is a 4, so 4g mm by d square. Now this is equal to what? Original force. So that will be 4f. Okay, so the new force will become 4 times of original force, or the actual value. Okay. Coming to question number 7, what is the importance of universal law of gravitation? That is a direct question. So this was all about homework solutions of lecture number 1. Thank you.